Okay, so we continue. Okay. So the goal of this exercise was to solve this negative frequency problem that we needed to get rid of. So for that we needed this expression. So z of omega equals the conjugate of z with an minus omega argument. So if we write then this expression in terms of real and imaginary parts, then we can do it as follows. So on the left hand side we have x omega plus y I times y omega, and on the left hand side x of minus omega minus I times y of minus omega. We can group this again in separate equations for the real and imaginary parts. So we see then that x of omega equals x of minus omega, and we see that y of minus omega equals minus y of minus omega equals minus y of omega. All right. So that last property, let's that evenness, we can use that on the equation for the real part that we had. So we can first split the integral that ran from minus infinity to infinity in two domains. So a part that runs from minus infinity to zero, and then a part that runs from zero to infinity. So let's leave that last part alone for a moment, and do some manipulation on the first term on the right hand side. So the first thing we can do is swap the integration boundaries. So instead of integrating from minus infinity to zero, we integrate from zero to minus infinity, and that allows us to change the minus sign that was in front of this term into a plus sign, indicated in red here. The second step is to change the sign on omega prime. And then again, that allows us to adjust the upper integration boundaries. We have to do that on the whole integral, so we do that in the argument of y, and we do that in the denominator. So that becomes omega plus omega prime then. And then in the last step, we can use this evenness property. So we can that is listed on the very top here of the slide, where we then again replace I of minus omega prime with y of plus omega prime, and then we have to again put in minus in front of the integral. So three steps that allowed us to change the integration range from minus infinity to infinity that we had that we started out with into an integration range from zero to infinity, which we were after. So now we have two integral terms that run both from zero to infinity. So we can group these back together. So this is the expression, and we can group them in this form. So we have a y of omega prime in both nominators. So we can regroup as follows. This part between the square brackets, we can cross multiply so that we get the rearrangement of the omega terms, and as you can see here and now in the nominator between the brackets there are some parts that will drop out. The omega primes will remain. We get a factor two. There's a minus sign that remains, so that cancels the minus sign in front of the integral. So this is what we end up with. So now we still have an expression of the real part x omega as an integral function of the imaginary part y of omega prime, but now due to this manipulation the integral runs from zero to plus infinity. So we got rid of the negative frequencies. So it is now, let's say, more compatible with the real world. Problem solved. We can do the same thing on the imaginary part. So these are going to be the same steps as before. So split again into two domains, minus infinity to zero and from zero to infinity. Swap the integration boundaries so that they run from zero to minus infinity, which yields a minus sign in front of the integral. Then change the sign of the argument within the integral, both in the nominator and the denominator, so that the integration boundaries now run from zero to plus infinity, and then finally use the evenness property for the real part. In this case, x omega is x minus omega, to get these two terms that that have the same domain and both have x omega in the nominator. Can regroup then into a single integral, and we again have this 1 over omega plus 1 over omega expressions in the square brackets within the integral, do the cross multiplication. Again, a few terms will cancel, and eventually we'll end up with this expression. So again, now the imaginary part, y omega, expressed as an integral of the real part, x of omega, as an integral relation. So finally, now we're actually getting somewhere. So again, the argument is, if we have a causal function z of t that describes the response of a system, the response is r of t and the input of the system is I of t, x of z of t is a real valued function, it is square integrable, so it vanishes as t goes to infinity, then z omega is the Fourier transform of zt, is going to be an even complex function. That is what we derived. And then the real and imaginary part of z omega, so x omega and y omega, are going to be related through dispersion relations, to Kramers-Kronig relations. And they are given here. So the real part is expressed as an integral over the imaginary part, and the imaginary part is expressed as an integral over the real part. The integration boundaries in our previous results ran from minus infinity to infinity. Now they run from 0 to infinity. So we've solved the negative frequencies, but we still have the practical problem that if you want to calculate x of omega, let's say for a single value of omega, then we still must know y omega, the imaginary part, over all frequencies. If you want to calculate a refractive index at a certain wavelength, then we need to know the absorption spectrum over wavelengths from 0 to infinity. So practically, we still have a little bit of a problem, but mathematically, we are on the solid ground now. Except for one thing, I want to derive it for the refractive index, but the refractive index is not an actual response function. There is not a system that has the refractive index as a response function. So the question is, can we actually write Kramers-Kronig relations for the refractive index if it is not a response function? So let's to show that we can under some assumptions. Let's start with the susceptibility Gi. If a dielectric is placed in an electric field, so it is illuminated, then an oscillating charge separation occurs, so that the dielectric becomes polarized. So in response to the incoming electric field is the input signal, the output, the response of the system is an induced dipole moment. Per unit volume, we can calculate, so that would be the polarization density p omega, and then the susceptibility is then the connecting response function. So the polarization density is given is the product of the susceptibility times the incident electric field. There's also a scaling factor there with, but still this so the susceptibility is a true response function. Now to go further, we basically need to dive a little bit deeper in the EM textbooks again. So here we can write in the Kramers-Kronig relation. We know from the susceptibility that it is related to the relative permittivity. So Gi is given by the relative permittivity minus 1. We also know that the refractive index is related to the relative permittivity as the square root of as the square root of the permittivity. This allows us to connect to tie these things together. We can write m of omega, the refractive index, as the square root of 1 plus the susceptibility. And if the susceptibility is very small, which is the basic assumption here, then we can approximate that as 1 plus a half times the susceptibility. This response is very weak. That is basically something that we always assume, also in the calculations of scattering and other responses. So it is not a wild assumption. It is generally valid for tissue-like materials. So now we have basically linear dependence between the refractive index and the susceptibility. So now we know that if we can write Kramers-Kronig relations for the susceptibility, then under this assumption, we can also write it for the refractive index. For the complex refractive index. So both the refractive index and the susceptibility are then complex quantities. So we can write the real. We can split again in real and imaginary parts. So the real parts n of omega correspond to 1 plus half times the real part of the susceptibility, and the imaginary parts correspond to a half times the imaginary part of the susceptibility. So we can write then the Kramers-Kronig integral for the real part of the susceptibility as a function of its imaginary part. Write that in terms and write both in terms of the real and imaginary part of the complex refractive index. So this is the result then on the left-hand side. We now have the real part of the refractive index. Within the integral, we get kappa, the imaginary part of the refractive index. And then a few more steps are needed. So we know that the imaginary part of the index is related to the absorption coefficient. UA was 2 times kappa times k. Kappa is equal to omega frequency divided by the speed of light. So we can also write UA as 2 times omega times kappa divided by c. So let's substitute that into the integral. And then finally, we have the expression that we saw before. So the real part of the refractive index is now expressed as an integral function of the absorption coefficient. We can do, for completeness, do the same exercise for the imaginary part, for kappa. So again, write the Kramers-Kronig relation for the susceptibility, imaginary part expressed as an integral of the real part. Then substitute for the refractive index components and rearrange in order to get the absorption coefficient as a function of the real part of the refractive index. There's one loose end, but I guess we can go quickly with that because we already discussed that a little bit earlier on. The loose end is that we still have this singularity in the denominator, and we solved that more or less solved that by writing this symbol p in front of the integrals, the Cauchy principal value. So if a function has a singularity, then what we basically do is just integrate up to that singularity, then make a little jump, and then integrate over the rest of the domain. So if you would write that down mathematically, it would look like this. We'll take this at face value. And then the final result is then the expression for the real part of the complex refractive index, now with p in there. And again, what remains to calculate it at a single frequency or a single wavelength, we still have to know the absorption spectrum over the whole frequency or whole wavelength range. And the same thing for the absorption part. Okay, yeah, same caveat. Okay, now let's take a look how that ends up. So let's take an on top you see the expression for the complex refractive index, and you see the Kramers-Kronig relation that expresses the real part as a function of the absorption coefficient. If we now want to calculate let's say the real part at any given value of omega, what this integral does is it multiplies the absorption spectrum with a weight function. That weight function is shifted to the frequency that we want to evaluate, and the weight function can be written as 1 over omega prime squared minus omega squared. You see a little sketch of that weight function here on the right hand side of the slide. So we multiply the absorption spectrum with that weight function, and the integral calculates the area under that curve, and that will give us, we have to add 1 and some constants, but that will give us the value of the real index at that frequency. So now let's assume an idealized absorption spectrum. So we have on the horizontal axis omega frequency, and it is normalized by the peak frequency, by the resonance frequency, so there it is 1. And then on the vertical axis, we have the absorption coefficient. So now we multiply this spectrum with the wave function, with the weight function, so 1 over omega prime squared minus omega squared. So that is just that weight function shifted to the frequency where we want to evaluate. If we now try to evaluate at an omega, at a frequency that is smaller than the resonance frequency, so on the left-hand side of the absorption peak. What you get is because you have to calculate the area under the product, there is more of the absorption spectrum on the right hand side than there is on the left hand side. So we get a small negative contribution. The peak goes down first and then swings up and decays again, and a large positive contribution, which means that will yield a high value of the real reflective index if you calculate the area under the curve. On the other hand, if you evaluate a frequency that is much higher than the resonance frequency, you will get a large negative contribution that is on the left hand part of the weight function, and a small positive contribution. So you will get a lower value of the real reflective index. And if you put the weight function exactly at resonance frequency, so exactly in the middle, then both contributions would be the same. So the result would be zero. So if you do that, if you step through the spectrum, so you evaluate this integral at all frequencies, then this is the result you will find. So if the frequency is less than resonance frequency, you will get higher values of the reflective index. At resonance, it will be zero or one, because we had to add one as well. And then if we go to frequencies that are higher than the resonance frequency, you'll get smaller negative contributions. So you get basically what you see is that you have a peak in an absorption spectrum, then in the spectrum of the reflective index, you will see an oscillation basically around that absorption peak. Let me briefly try to visualize that. I hope this works. To share a different screen, one moment. Yeah, so this is just a simulation. So here you see that same absorption spectrum, that same absorption peak, and here is the weight function. So it actually starts a little bit earlier, then dips down, then swings up, and then it has this tail over here. So when we want to calculate the real part of the absorption spectrum, the real part of the refractive index, that's what you're going to see in the middle figure. Then the weight function, the black curve, is going to shift. And each time, for each shift, we calculate the area under the curve. That is what the under the curve of the product. That is what the integral does. And that value, resulting value, will be shown in the middle graph. So the top graph is a function of frequency omega. The middle graph is as a function of frequency omega. And then the lower graph, I'm going to plot as function of wavelength, so 1 over omega. So that's going to have a different scaling. So, but let's run it, then you can see what happens. So now we go to peak, and then it dips down, and then goes back up again. Okay, so this the top and the middle graph. So the top graph is just the imaginary part. The middle graph is the real part of both this function of frequency. And then if you plot the same real part of the index as a function of wavelength, you see that the result is looks a little bit different, but that is simply due to the scaling of the horizontal axis. So lambda is proportional to one over the frequency. Back to the slide. So that was the result of that. All right. So now, once I back, okay. Let's look a little bit closer at what happens. At what happens in these two graphs. So if you have an absorption peak like here with at omega resonance, then on a frequency axis you would get an oscillation in the real part of the refractive index, just centered at that frequency, at that resonance frequency. Of course, if you plot it on a wavelength scale, you still have that oscillation, and the center of the oscillation or the still occurs at this now resonance wavelength. So that tells us that if we have an absorption peak somewhere, then there will be also on the wavelength spectrum there will be an oscillation in the real part of the refractive index. And not only that, we also see that if that absorption peak is large enough, then for higher wavelengths, larger wavelengths, just a little bit away from the absorption peak, but at larger wavelengths, we will see a decrease of the real part of the refractive index with wavelength. So that is this region here. So here the real part of the refractive index decreases, and that is due to this absorption peak that is centered here. And now this makes you allows you to understand a little bit better what happens here. So we took this piece of glass. Take this piece of glass again. If you look up the properties, then this is the transmission of that glass as a function of wavelength. Well, transmission is, of course, if the transmission is low, that means the absorption is high. So that tells us that here, around 300 nanometers, there is a huge absorption peak. As a result of that absorption peak, we have at wavelengths that are larger than the absorption peak, so here starting at 400 nanometers, we get a decrease of the real part of the refractive index. So that same absorption peak that was responsible for you not getting a tan behind the glass window is also via this Kramers-Kronig relation, so via causality, causes this decay of real decay of the real part of the refractive index with wavelength. And if you know this, then you can use that in the prism equation, and then you can actually calculate how this light will be dispersed by that prism. All right. Just to see if this landed a little bit, I have two small questions for you. So this is again an absorption spectrum, but if you look closely, you see now that there is a very little extra peak over here. So can you now predict how the spectrum of the real part of the refractive index would look like on a wavelength scale? So with these two peaks and then on a wavelength scale. And then the second question is, now let's start with this one first. So I'll just to help you a little bit out, I'll put this light on. And now I want you to try to figure out how it would look like if I would have an extra but small absorption peak over here. All right, I think that that's excellent. This one I can actually show you in the same in that same simulation. So if I can find it. Okay, so now magically a second peak is going to appear. Yep, there it is. But yep, you get a small oscillation for the first peak and then a larger oscillation for the for the larger peak. So on the frequency axis, the oscillation for the smaller absorption peak is just going to occur at that frequency, and the oscillation for the larger peak, of course, occurs around the center of the larger absorption peak. So on the frequency axis, it will be small peak here, small oscillation here, large peak here, larger oscillation here. But then if you that was the question, if you then plot it or sketch it on this inverted wavelength scale, then the location of the peaks changes, of course. So then the larger oscillation is here for the lower wavelength, and the smaller oscillation is around here for the larger at the larger wavelength. You ask if the smaller peak was way more to the left, would an omega graph also still be a little bump? No, you would still be able to see it, I guess. But so now what you and now it right now it rides a little bit on top of the other oscillation, so it's amplified a little bit. But in principle, it is you can just basically just write it as a linear combination. Yeah, maybe I can. I'm not sure if I
But
have.
like if you move the small peak very far away so that they are no longer overlapping,
Yeah.
wouldn't you expect the first curve or bump of the index, would you expect it to go up and down too?
Yeah, so you would so basically what you so try the one band again. So basically you would just get a copy of this signal, but then much then shifted, of course, and much less in amplitude. So if you have basically you can just decompose the absorption spectrum in a series of peaks, just a linear combination of peaks, and they will all give they will all give give an oscillation like this, and then the result is going is just a linear combination of these oscillations. So if they're far apart and the tails don't overlap, then you would just see two separate copies. And if they are closer together, and then the tails may overlap, and then you get a little bit more.
Yeah, okay, I hadn't foreseen the overlap, but it's clear. Thanks.
Okay. And then back to the slides. Okay. Yeah. So then the second question that is that one is a little bit more complicated. So this is now the sketch of the real part of the reflective index as a function of wavelength. Can you now using this sketch or estimate? I mean, just a sketch of the absorption spectrum in this same wavelength range.
Good. So now the entire wavelength part is decreasing too.
Yeah, so the trend so let's say the trend is that the real part decreases with wavelength, and on top of that are these two oscillations. Yeah, this one is really a little bit more complicated. So let's start with the trend first. So if we have we have a decrease of the real part of the index with wavelength. What does that imply? Just think back of the glass example.
Oh, so that there's at a higher wavelength, there's a lot of absorption happening.
Yeah, at a lower wavelength.
A lower wavelength. So
for the glass was if you had a huge absorption in the UV, so let's say around 300 nanometer, and then you had this decay of refractive index in the visible part, so let's say around 600 nanometer. And so a huge peak at a lower wavelength causes a decay at the higher wavelengths. So here, if you now see it in this wavelength range, the trend is decaying. So that suggests that there is a huge absorption peak somewhere at the lower wavelength that you cannot see here, but there is. That is one suggestion. The other thing is that you see two oscillations here. I'm not exactly sure where, but a small oscillation at around, let's say, 1400 nanometer, and larger oscillations, let's say, around 1800 nanometer. Agreed? An oscillation in the real part of the index. So the center of that oscillation corresponded to the center of an absorption peak. So by estimating where the center of the oscillation is, you can more or less estimate where the absorption peaks are going to be. And then the third thing is that that a larger absorption peak gives rise to a larger oscillation. So we can infer here that we have two peaks in this somewhere in this wavelength range, one at about 1400 nanometers and one at about 1900 nanometers, and that one at the higher wavelength at 1800 nanometers is the largest one because that has a higher amplitude in the oscillation. So this we already did. So my sketch would then more or less look like this. There is this huge peak somewhere at a lower wavelength that we cannot see in this graph, but that will have, let's assume that there is still a tail of that visible. So that's why I drew a little decay here as well. And then around these two, the two center wavelengths of this, of these two oscillations, there will be that will be the center of the absorption peaks. So they will be about here. And then because the oscillation at apparently I estimated 950 earlier is higher, the absorption peak there will be higher as well. That's the reasoning. Is that
I don't really get your confusion in the I'm talking about in the chat right now, but this graph is like the same as the previous one, but then with the x-axis reversed, right?
So with the omega, with on the frequency, yeah. So it is because wavelength is proportional to 1/(ω), the axis is reversed and it is compressed and stretched a little bit because of this.
But you were talking about my second bump isn't higher, something. Well,
it is.
I'm responding to Sharon and your.
Oh, sorry. I'm sorry. I'll keep out of it.
The problem was for me that the bump started to move downward first, while in the previous example it moved upward. And so that didn't make sense unless it got cancelled by the trend. But I was totally having tunnel vision on having the bigger or the trend or the bigger peak at the right side outside of the frame instead of on the left side, which was of course also a possibility, but I didn't think that. So that's why I was confused.
Okay. Yeah. And I was completely off the mark. I thought we had to do the inverse of the first question. So we had to do the K omega peak, but seeing the answer, I was not correct whatsoever.
Okay, but now I understand you guys too, so that's fine. Thank you.
So then to finalize that, does this analysis make sense now, or do you? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it does.
Okay. Well, then otherwise. Okay. Last question for you, and then I'm just going to give you some examples. So we still had this, so we made some sketches now that works nicely, but if you really want to do the calculation on real data, then you still run into the problem that you need to know this absorption coefficient over the whole wavelength or the whole frequency range, and that is just simply not possible. But we can solve that a little bit. Now, suppose that we know through a measurement the real refractive index at some frequency, and let's call it omega zero. Can you now give an expression for a subtractive Cramer-Kronig relation? So calculate the relation for n omega minus n omega zero, n omega zero being the value that we know. So of course, and that's the hint to get you going, for n omega zero, this relation also holds, this integral relation also holds. It holds for every frequency, so also for omega zero. Can you try to simplify that equation?
I think I have an answer, but it's a lot to write in the chat. So. I think you're muted.
Thanks. Okay, can you describe it or hold it up maybe? Or
I can try. Can you read this? The last line.
Yeah. I can see the denominator, and that looks fine. So I'm going to assume that the rest is okay as well.
Okay. Denominator is mu a times omega zero squared minus omega squared.
Yeah. So what we can do is we can write the integral expression here. We can write it for here it is written for omega, for a general omega. But of course, if we want to evaluate at some omega zero, some value, then we can do the same thing. We can just substitute omega zero here and omega zero there, and then subtract the two. So basically, the subtraction of the two integrals is here. In black is the integral for omega. In blue is the integral for omega zero. You can see it is replaced here. Well, then obviously the ones cancel, but the integral domains stay the same, the mu a in the denominator stays the same, the front vector stays the same, so we can simply combine this into a single integral, again with this 1 over omega minus 1 over omega, let's say a term within the square brackets. So that we can simplify by doing the cross products, and that some terms cancel as we're used to, so we end up with this. Within the square brackets. Now you can also see that that here in the numerator in the square brackets there is no omega prime, which was the integration variable. So this, for as far as the integral is concerned, is just a constant. So we can put that, bring that out of the integral, and then the final result is this. So n of omega, I brought the value n omega zero that we knew to the other side. So then we have this estimation. N of omega is the known value, and then this shift here, and then a new integral, but now with a more complex denominator. We have now omega squared minus omega prime squared, and then omega zero squared minus omega prime squared, and the absorption spectrum is still the same. Is this the answer that you had as well? The denominator looked great, but the other part I could not read.
Yes, I have it as well.
Okay, excellent. Okay, so what is the benefit of this? So if you take a closer look, then we now see two times an omega prime squared here in the denominator. So graphically, what it means, before if you want in the old equation, if you want to calculate n at a given frequency, we had to multiply the mu a spectrum with this weight function, this shifted weight function, which is given by 1 over omega prime squared minus omega squared. Now, because we have so basically this was proportional to 1 minus 1 over omega squared. But now, because we have two times this omega prime term, omega prime squared term, the weight function now scales with 1 over omega prime to the fourth power. So that is a much narrower weight function. So we can now multiply our spectrum with this much narrower function, and then perform the integration. And we're much less sensitive to missing data at the outer edges. So if we can make this weight function narrower, then we actually only have to know the spectrum around the point that we try to evaluate, and we can relax the necessity a little bit of knowing it from zero to infinity. So it reduces the error. So in that way, it's more practical. So if we can do a reference measurement of n omega, then we can simplify it. And of course, we can expand this if we know the refractive index at yet another frequency. Yet another wavelength, we can do this again, and then all of a sudden it scales with omega prime to the sixth power, so it gets even narrower. So this way we can reduce these errors, and it's not so not so important anymore that we don't know the spectrum from zero to infinity. Jan? Okay. Then, 1 second. I have to cough off camera. Back to the biology. So again, the rule of thumb is roughly speaking that if we have a large absorption peak somewhere at UV wavelengths, then the rule of thumb is that that the real part of the refractive index is going to decrease with wavelength in the visible part. So let's apply that to water. Important, of course, because 70% of tissues is water. So you can imagine that the refractive index of tissue is largely determined by that of water. And then, of course, we also know that that the real part of the refractive index is one of the input parameters for all the scattering theories. So if we want to understand scattering, then it's important to know how this refractive index behaves. And the other one is hemoglobin, an oxygenated hemoglobin, which is key to understand scattering by red blood cells. So there we go. This is on a log-log scale, the real and imaginary part of the refractive index of water over a very large wavelength range, so from 10 nanometers up to 10 meters. And it's a little bit hard to see because it's now on because it's on this log-log scale, but you have this very large absorption peak here in the UV, and that causes in the visible part of the wavelength range, so that is around this circle where the absorption is very low. It causes a decrease of the real part of the refractive index in the visible wavelength region. So that is again the rule of thumb. And then, of course, you see all these extra absorption peaks that and each of them causes this very little ripple oscillation on top of it. And then here, if you go very far into the infrared, there is this there is again a huge absorption peak, and that again causes. Causes a modulation in the real part of the index. So if we zoom in a little bit on the real part, on the visible part, I'm sorry, then this is the zoomed in version, the real part of the refractive index from 400 to 700 nanometers. And as you can see, it is indeed a decaying function of wavelength. Quick question, you see a couple of graphs here. They are measured at different temperatures. So we see here that the real part of the refractive index of water depends on temperature. What does that imply for the absorption coefficient?
Isn't this kind of referring to the first lectures with the different absorption coefficients for suspensions and solutions? So the structure is different at different temperatures.
Yeah, but this is for water, so we don't even have the solutions and the suspensions here. But the way of thinking is, I guess, is right. So we found out that the absorption and the absorption spectrum and the real part of the refractive index are related. So if one goes up, then the other one will change as well. So that means that if the real part of the refractive index is temperature dependent, then the absorption coefficient will also be temperature dependent. So that's what you can conclude from this and then it's true. That's also measured, so that works. Okay, this is an example for hemoglobin. So on the left hand side you see the absorption spectrum. Absorption coefficient spectrum for hemoglobin and oxyhemoglobin over a quite limited wavelength range, but you can still do this Kramers-Kronig analysis on this data. So first you have to convert, or use the equation as we had it, and then calculate the real part of the refractive index here as a function of wavelength for oxy and deoxyhemoglobin. You see two dots here. These are measurement points. So we used a subtractive Kramers-Kronig analysis here to scale the spectrum up to the measurement point. Of course, it has to go through the measurement point, and it made sure that um, uh, that uh, that that we made only small arrows around the edges. You can see here at the lower wavelength, so where we don't have enough data, that that it is actually going to be unreliable because it will not drop so steeply down. But still, that quite works. And of course, again, around the high absorption peaks, so here at around 400 nanometers, you see this large, larger oscillation in the real part of the index. And here at the smaller, somewhat smaller absorption peaks are recognizable here as well. So this is an old measurement that or an old calculation, I should say, that ran from 200 to 1000 nanometers using this data as input. Then if you dive in the literature, you can find more spectra, more data. So if you stitch that all together, you can achieve a larger wavelength range. So we tried that too. And then the result is shown here. So now it runs from 250 to about 2000 nanometers for both oxygenated and deoxygenated hemoglobin. It looks more or less the same. And you also see that not a lot is happening, not a lot is happening here. This is a hemoglobin, so the contents of a red blood cell. You can also do that for plasma. So in blood, the red blood cells are suspended in plasma, so you can find the refractive index of plasma as well. And if you know these two, then you can actually do light scattering calculations. You know the refractive index of the particle, you know the refractive index of the medium, you know the size of a red blood cell, so you have all the inputs you need to do scattering calculations. One funny thing here in dotted gray, because I tried to hide it a little bit, is a measurement, an actual measurement of the real part of the refractive index. That is really hard to do, but they succeeded in doing it. What do you notice? What are the... So if you compare my calculations, the colored curves to the measurement that you see there.
Right, it's higher everywhere.
It's higher everywhere, yeah, exactly. That's one.
Yeah, and there's instead of like there, they measure a peak at the lower wavelengths.
Yeah, yeah. So it's higher. That is there can be a couple of explanations for that. So maybe the colored spectrum lies where it is because of these measurement points. So in the top graph, you don't see them in the lower graph, but that is the same points. These two are measured, and that's why these curves lie here. He measured it as well, or they measured it as well, and they come up a little bit higher. That can be due to the way it was measured. It can be due to some chemical treatment in order to get the to get the hemoglobin out of the red blood cells. So there you can speculate why that is. I would have preferred if they overlap more, but I'm not very worried that they don't. The second thing is that at least the peaks correspond more or less. They are at the same position and they follow the same behavior. So that's good. And then the last thing, and that's what you said, Jorik, that's exactly correct. Here the refractive index goes up, and here it wobbles a little bit at the constant level. So who do you think is right in this case?
I'm not sure. It almost looks like the plasma effect is added on top of the hemoglobin and oxyglobin spectra.
Yeah, that could be that. So you always start out with red blood cells, which you have to. So basically, what you usually do is you take the red blood cells, you centrifuge them so that you separate plasma and the blood cells. Then you tap out the red blood cells and let them burst so that the hemoglobin becomes free, then you centrifuge again so that the cell membranes go at the bottom of the cuvette, and you can again filter to take out the hemoglobin solution. If that filtering step does not work entirely well, then you can have some residue of plasma. That's true. That could happen. The other thing is that measurement at these low wavelengths are extremely difficult because it's hard to find a light source there, it's hard to find good detectors there, and it's hard to find good optics there that do not influence your measurement too much. So the measurement is really difficult there. So that would that could be that could be an argument to say, no, I guess the calculation is right. On the other hand, what we're looking at now is at the edge of the spectrum, and our calculation, regardless of the fact that we use the subtractive Kramers-Kronig relation, our equation or calculation still assumes that we know data over the whole wavelength range. And we also know that if we shift this weight function to the edge of the spectrum that we know, that the errors are going to be biggest there. So it's entirely possible. I think it's even likely that there is computational error in our part here. So truth will be well, maybe somewhere in between. But in this case, I would say I still trust the measurement more than the calculation at that at these points. All right. Why do all this stuff? Why do I do the calculations? Well, because experiments on blood are not so easy. This is an old photograph of me actually trying to measure this n omega relation, because we could not measure the refractive index at all the wavelengths we needed. So we decided to do the computational approach, but we needed a reference measurement. So here we have an optics lab, which is all kinds of sensitive equipment, and then all of a sudden you have to have some circulation setup where you pump around blood that and a million things can go wrong, and sometimes they actually do. So here a little tube burst, and then I spent about a month cleaning all the optics again. So in this case I would really prefer to do the calculations. And then the last joke of the day, the one property to rule them all. So we had this complex refractive index with a real part that is an input to light scattering theories. We have an imaginary part that is proportional to the absorption coefficient. It is directly related to the absorption spectrum. So basically, if we have knowledge of the if you have knowledge of the complex refractive index, we have a tool to calculate all these optical properties and understand these optical properties better. So in summary for today, causality dictates that the real and imaginary part of a physical response function are related. This relation is expressed in the Kramers-Kronig equations. You saw them expressing the real part as a function of the imaginary part and vice versa. The refractive index, although it is not a strict response function, we can still derive Kramers-Kronig relations for it under the assumption that that the interaction between light and tissue is very weak, and that is in most cases a just assumption. Then the imaginary part of the complex refractive index is related to the absorption coefficient, so that means that we expressed these relations as between the real part and omega and the absorption coefficient, mu a of omega. Calculating a single value of n omega requires, in principle, knowledge of the absorption spectrum from zero to infinite frequencies. This is in practice, of course, not possible. And we can alleviate it a little bit by using this subtractive Kramers-Kronig method. So basically, the more data we can put in, the more compact and the more compact the support of our calculation becomes and the more reliable the result. And then finally, again, once again, the rule of thumb: if you have a large absorption peak in the UV, then this will cause a decrease of the real part of the refractive index with wavelength in the visible spectral region. All right, this was my message for today. Any questions?
I'm good. Thanks for your lecture.
All right, then I wish you a pleasant afternoon.
Bye.
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 Bye.